بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and welcome to the Arabic lessons. This is Al-Madina Islamic University Arabic syllabus. Al-Madina, Islamic University of Al-Madina, their textbooks. That's the one we are learning here. And that is اللغة العربية لغير ناطقين بها. So, as we mentioned on the onset, it's important to learn Arabic language. Why is it important to learn Arabic language? It is the language used by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to communicate to the creation. And that is sufficient to learn Arabic language. Okay? So it's very important to learn Arabic language as Muslims because we use Arabic language every day in our Salah. So you need to understand what you are reciting in Salah so that you can have khushu, you can, you know, concentrate in Salah. It's very important. So as an introduction, we are going to learn about the speeches, the types of speeches in Arabic language. Okay? Aqsamul Kalam. Aqsam al-Kalam, types of speeches in Arabic language. So there are three types of speeches in Arabic language. Aqsam al-Kalam, thalatha. There are three. We have ismun, ismun. We have fi'lun, and harfun. Ismun, fi'lun, and harfun. These are the three types of speeches in Arabic, or the three types of words in Arabic. Okay? Ismun is a noun, and fi'lun is a verb, and harfun is a particle. Okay? Any type of word that you have in Arabic language, any type of word is either ismun or fi'lun or harfun. So ismun here is a noun, fi'lun is a verb, and then harfun is a particle.
Sorry for the interruption. Harfun, can it not also mean preposition?
Yes, harfun can mean a preposition here, but we use it as a particle in general. You know, when you say preposition is specific, but just say particle, it's just a particle, okay, or a preposition. So ismun, fi'lun, and harfun, any type of word. For example, we can say waladun. Waladun means what?
A boy.
Waladun means a boy. So where does boy falls here? Is it an ism or a fi'l or a harf? It is a noun, it is ism. Another type is, for example, we have kataba. Kataba is what?
Write.
To write, or he wrote, okay? So where does it fall to? Okay, it is fi'l, it is a verb. And then we have fi or min. For example, let's say waladun here. Waladun. This is a boy. And then here, kataba. Kataba means he wrote. Or to write. To write. He wrote or to write. Okay? What about the particle here? We have min. Or we can have fi. And then we have ala, for example. This is what we call huruful jar. Huh? Huruful jar. So it's very important to know this type of types of speeches that we have in Arabic. Isim, fi'l and harf, okay? A noun, a verb, and a particle, okay? These are the three types of speeches we have in Arabic language. So if I ask you, ma hiya aqsamul kalam, what are the types of speeches we have in Arabic language? You have to say here, they are, ismun, fi'lun, and harfun. So any speech, any word in Arabic language, whether it's coming from the Quran, or it's coming from Hadith, or it's coming from normal conversation, any word, it falls, either it's an ism, or fi'l, or harf. For example, we have hadha baytun. Hadha baytun. For example, hadha baytun. Hadha baytun. Hadha itself alone, where does it fall to? Hadha ismun. In fact, it's called ismul. Ismul ishara. It's a demonstrative noun. It's a demonstrative noun. So hadha, it is ismun here. What about baytun? Baytun means what? A house. So this is a house. Hadha baytun. This is a house. This is a house. So baytun also, it is ismun. Okay? So this is a sentence. And then if you break down the sentence, you can have both parts of the sentence to be part of the noun. Okay? So this is just an example. Al-fi'l, for example, we have kataba Muhammadun. Kataba Muhammadun, for example, we have, let's write it here. Kataba Muhammadun. Kataba Muhammadun. Kataba is what? Muhammad wrote. Okay? Muhammad wrote. We have kataba Allahu. Okay? So Muhammad wrote. Kataba, where does it fall to? It is a verb. And then Muhammadun is what? It's ismun. It's a noun. So this one also, Muhammadun fil masjidi. For example, we have Muhammadun fil masjidi. Muhammadun fil masjidi. Muhammad is in the masjid. Okay? Okay, Muhammadun is what? It is ismun here. It falls under ismun. What about fi? Fi means in. Where does it fall to? It is a harf. And then masjidi is what? It is ismun. Okay? This huruf, they only come, they can only penetrate a noun. Okay? Like fil masjidi. Masjidi is a noun. That's why we have fi. Okay? Because there is a rule in Arabic language that says al-fi'lu la yujarru abadan. Al-fi'lu la yujarru abadan. Fi'l, a verb cannot have kasra. A verb cannot have kasra. Al-fi'lu la yujarru abadan. Okay? So the verb cannot have a kasra. Meaning, la tadukhulu alayhi al-kasratu i'raban. Okay? So we cannot have fi before a verb. It's not possible because it cannot have kasra. Like kataba, fi katabi. Have you ever heard about that? It never happened. So therefore, fi can only enter in a noun, into a noun. Okay? Fi can only enter into a noun. These are just examples for you to know the types of speeches in Arabic language. Waladun, for example, falls into under the category of a noun. Kataba, verb. And then fi, min, ala, an, they're all part of huruf. Okay? So these are the three types of speeches we have in Arabic language. All right. So when we know the type of speeches, now we go to the types of sentences in Arabic language. Okay? أقسام الجملة. So we have, there are only two types of sentences, types of sentences in Arabic language. We have only two types of sentences in Arabic language. One is al-jumlatul الجملة الإسمية الجملة الإسمية a nominal sentence This is the first type of sentence we have. For now, just assume that we have only two types of sentences. الجملة الإسمية That is the first one. And then we have al-jumlatul fi'liya. But first, let's deal with this one. Al-jumlatul ismiya is a nominal sentence. It's any sentence that begins with a noun. Okay? Just say a noun. Any sentence that begins with a noun. Okay? It's a nominal sentence. This nominal sentence is divided before we have the composition of a nominal sentence, we have two things. We have al-mubtada'u. We can have mubtada'un wa khabarun. Mubtada'un and khabarun. These two forms, the combination of these two will give you Jumlatul ismiya. That's why they said in Arabic, huwa or hiya murakkabatun ala mubtada'in wa khabarin. A nominal sentence is composed of mubtada and khabar. Mubtada means subject, the subject of the sentence, and khabar means predicate. This is the first type of sentence we have in Arabic language. Okay, we have mubtada and we have khabar. Okay, these two forms, combination of the two will give you jumlatul ismiya, a nominal sentence. For example, who can give me an example of jumlatul ismiya? Naam. Hada waladun. Okay? Hada waladun. Hada waladun. This is a boy. This is a boy. Okay? It's jumlatul ismiya because it begins with a noun. So hada is mubtada and waladun is khabar. It's the subject and the predicate. So it's a complete sentence. This is a boy. Any other example? Muhammadun. Muhammadun Talibun. Let's have that one. Muhammadun Talibun. What is the meaning? Muhammad is a student. Muhammadun Talibun. Muhammad is a student. So Muhammad is here, is what you call the mubtada, the subject. And talibun is what? Is khabar, is the predicate. So we have so many examples here. I think these two examples are enough. These are nominal sentences. Any sentence is either a nominal sentence or a verbal sentence. So now we go back to the second type of sentence now. So the second type of sentence is al-jumlatul al-jumlatul fi'liya. الجملة الفعلية, a verbal sentence. الجملة الفعلية, the verbal sentence. So this is the second type of sentence that we have in Arabic language. الجملة الفعلية. It is also composed of two things. Okay? For you to have a جملة الفعلية, you need two things. Number one is what? It has, you must have the verb, فعل. فعل, verb. And then, فاعل. Means door of the action. Door of the action. The one who does the action is called fa'il. And then fa'il is the verb. So these are the two things that composes, that makes you to have a jumlatul fi'aliyah, a verbal sentence. That's why we said here murakkabatun ala fa'ilin wa fa'ilin. Okay? It is composed of fi'l and fa'il, the verb and the one who does the action. Can we have an example of jumlatul fi'liyah? It's any sentence that begins with a verb. Okay? Any sentence that begins with a verb. Yes. Akala Muhammadun. Akala. The brother is saying about akala again. Are you hungry? Akala? Muhammad has eaten. Okay? Muhammad has eaten. Akala Muhammadun. Okay? Muhammad has eaten. But you have to tell us, what did Muhammad eat? What did he eat? Huh? At-ta'ama. Because when you say akala, sometimes you can bring the mafulun bihi. This is the object. Later we learn it in chapter 5. Okay? So, akala Muhammadun at-tu'ama. Okay? Muhammad has eaten food. Muhammad has eaten food. So, akala, you see, al-jumlatul fi'liya, it's any sentence that begins with a verb. Akala is, where is the verb here? Huh? Akala is the verb. This is the verb. This is the fi'l. And then, where is the fa'il? The one who does the action. Muhammad. Okay? This is a further lesson. We will learn it. It's called Mafulun Bihi. Okay? But Akala Muhammadun. Akala is fi'il and fa'il. The one who does the action is Muhammad. So this is an example of a verbal sentence. Al Jumlatul Fi'liya. Any other example? Darasa. Darasa Talibun. Ad-Darsa. Darasa talibun is still complete. The student has learned darasa. A darasa talib, you can say naam darasa talib. Yes. Wasala. Huh? Wasala. Wasala Muhammadun. Wasala, a very beautiful verb. Wasala. Uh-huh. Muhammad. What is the meaning of wasala Muhammadun? Muhammad has arrived. Okay, wasala Muhammadun. Wasala is what? Is the verb. You say fi'l. Okay, is the verb. And then Muhammadun is fa'il, the one who does the action. It's complete. Wasala Muhammad. Muhammad has arrived. When I was entering, I asked one of the students, awasalta? He doesn't understand. So you have to say, naam wasaltu. We did it. Fi'l madi. Okay? You can compose those three letter verbs. Now you should be okay with them. You can use the 12 pronouns to conjugate them accordingly. So wasala Muhammadun, Muhammad has arrived. If I ask you, awasalta, don't say naam. If you see someone responding naam, he is not confident. You have to complete it. Naam wasaltu. Okay? Akalta tu'ama? Have you eaten food? Don't say naam and stop there. You say naam Akal to. As beginners, you have to complete. If you're an expert, you have no problem with that. Okay? So learn how to complete responses. So these are the two types of verbs in a summary, sentences. Al-jumlatul ismiya and jumlatul fi'aliya. These are the two types of sentence we have in Arabic. The nominal sentence and the verbal sentence. The nominal sentence is composed of two things. The mubtada and the khabar, the subject and the predicate. Okay? And then al-jumlatul fi'aliya murakkabatun, it is composed of fi'il wal fa'il. Okay? So these are all examples of this jumlatul fi'aliya, and we have those of jumlatul ismiya. But if you are asked the types of sentences in Arabic, don't say nominal sentence. It's not an English class, it is Arabic class. So you have to respond using the Arabic text. Okay? So you say, here jumlatul ismiya and jumlatul fi'aliya. That's all. So what are the two compositions of, what are the composition of jumlatul fi'aliya? You say, it is composed of what? Mubtada, fi'il and fa'il. Well, jumlatul ismiya, it is composed of mubtada and khabar. Khalas. So we had an example. Let's have this one. Let's say, dhahaba. Dhahaba. Muhammadun. And then Muhammadun Zahaba. Have you seen these two? Pay attention here. Zahaba Muhammadun and Muhammadun Zahaba. What is the meaning of Zahaba Muhammadun? Muhammad has gone. What about Muhammadun Zahaba? The same meaning. Good. Sometimes Zahaba Muhammadun went Muhammadun. Don't say that. Okay? Say Muhammad has gone. Okay? And then Muhammadun Zahaba, they all have the same meaning. They all means what? Huh? Muhammad? Which one is the right word? Muhammad went. Muhammad went. Or has gone. Okay? Or left. Muhammad left. Muhammad went. I think we can use has gone. He has gone. Huh? That's why English is complicated. English is complicated. We have to avoid using much English here. Because when we use English, it may not match the Arabic language. Okay, example, you have you in English. Anta means you. Anti means you. Antuma means antum. Antunna. So if you are not here and someone is speaking to someone, is addressing them, hey, you come. Would you know how many people is addressing? But in Arabic, you say antunna, use antunna and tell them to come. You know he's talking about group of females. Antum, idhabu, you people go. You will know that even if you don't see the person talking or you don't see the people he's addressing to. So you should be able to know that he's addressing group of males because of antum. Antuma, two people. So that is the there's a reason why Allah used Arabic language, because it's the most comprehensive language. Okay? So now, Muhammad has gone. Which one is Jumlatul Ismiya and which one is Jumlatul Fi'aliya? The first one, Dhahaba Muhammadun, is Jumlatul Fi'aliya. It's a verbal sentence because it begins with a verb. Uh-huh. What about the second one? Is Jumlatul Fi'aliya or Jumlatul Ismiya? Someone said it's Jumlatul Fi'aliya because, let me guide you. A Jumlatul Ismiya is any sentence that begins with a noun. A Jumlatul Ismiya. A Jumlatul Fi'aliya, yes, is any sentence that begins with a verb. Jumlatul Fi'aliya, that's the verbal sentence. It begins with a verb. A Jumlatul Ismiya is any sentence that begins with a noun. So now tell me. Yes.
You know, when we were doing, when we were explaining al-jumlatul ismiya, we identified the features. We said it has to have mubtada, al-khabar.
Jumlatul ismiya?
Yeah, jumlatul
yes.
But we said for jumlatul fi'liya, it has to have a fa'il,
And fail. And fail, yes.
And both sentences have those qualities.
Good job. He said there's a fi'l in both sentences, so that's why this one he can justify it as a jumlatul fi'liyah.
Yes, because when we were explaining, we did not say that it starts with, we said it has to show these things.
Yes.
So to start with, hand to hand.
Yeah, let me clear this issue here. A jumlatul ismiyah is anyone that begins with a noun. That's a nominal sentence. Al-jumlatul fi'liyah is any sentence that begins with a verb. Take it that way. All right. So now, coming back to you, which one is this? Based on my explanation. Muhammadun Zahaba, where does it fall to?
Based on your explanation.
Yes.
Muhammad Zahaba,
jumlatul ismiyah. Because it begins with
a
noun, an ism. Good. So, Zahaba Muhammadun, Zahaba here is what? This is an example of jumlatul fi'liyah. A verbal sentence because it begins with a verb. Zahaba is the verb and Muhammadun is the one who does the action, is fa'il. What about Muhammadun Zahaba? Muhammadun Zahaba is an example of al-jumlatul ismiya. Okay? Masmuka, what is your name? My name is Muhammad. So obviously this is jumlatul ismiya. It begins with a noun. Okay? So here we have the mubtada, the combination. Is Muhammad is the mubtada. Where is the khabar? Zahaba is the khabar. And have you taken some food today? I think you have not taken lunch. Mashallah. Okay, Zahaba here is khabar.
Okay.
Yes. It's khabar. There are different types of khabar. So khabar comes as it comes as what? Jumlatul? It comes as jumlatul ismiya. Sometimes it comes as jumlatul fi'liya. Okay? So for example, we can have here Muhammadun Zahaba. So Muhammad is the mubtada and then khabar is Zahaba. Zahaba is a complete jumlatul fi'liya. It's a complete verbal sentence. Zahaba is a complete verbal sentence. Because when you say Zahaba, Zahaba is the fi'l. Where is the fa'il? It's damiru mustatir. It's a hidden pronoun. Okay? It's a hidden pronoun. Jawazan taqdiruhu huwa. Okay? Huwa is the estimation. So you can say huwa zahaba. Okay? So when you say zahaba, aina Muhammad, you say zahaba. It's a complete sentence. The zahaba itself. It's a complete sentence. Jumlatul fi'liya. So Muhammadun here is the mubtada, and then zahaba is the khabar as jumlatul fi'liya. Okay? Yes. So why is the one who does the action here? In the second sentence, who does the action? If you want to make Arab, Muhammad is mubtada, and then Zahaba is khabar. So fi'l here is Zahaba. Okay, fi'l is Zahaba, and this Zahaba is a complete what? Jumlatul fi'liya. So Zahaba, he went. Who does the action? Where's the fa'il? Fa'il is damirun mustatir. Fa'il is not Muhammad. Because fa'il comes after the fi'l. Like this fa'il, it must come after the verb. The door of the action always comes after the verb. So here you cannot say Muhammad is the door of the action. It's not the fa'il. You say fa'ilun damiru mustatir. Damir, it is a pronoun, a hidden pronoun. But taqdiruhu huwa yadullu ala Muhammad. That's another level. We will learn it. But here for your information, Muhammad is not the fa'il. Fa'il is damirun mustatir. It is a hidden pronoun, meaning Muhammad, okay? All right, so these are the two types of sentences we have in Arabic language. As you can see, al-jumlatul ismiya and jumlatul fi'liya. So now we can go back to the book. Inshallah, we start this is durus al-lughah al-arabiyyah li ghayri natiqin biha. Okay? Lessons of Arabic language for non-native speakers. Okay? It is durus al-lughah al-arabiyyah li ghayri natiqin biha. It is taught in Islamic University of Al-Madinah. Okay? It is taught in Islamic University of Al-Madinah. So we are going to use the one that is purely in Arabic. You have some books that are translated, both Arabic and English, they are mixed together. But when you learn Arabic, use Arabic language to learn Arabic language. It's very important, okay? Or use your mother tongue to learn Arabic language. It helps than to use, for example, a foreign language to learn another language. It becomes difficult. I don't know whether you understand what I'm... Yes, okay? If you use your mother tongue to learn another language, you understand it better than using another language to learn another language. And if you use the same language to learn the same language, it also gives you another advantage. Provided you can be guided, it's going to be very difficult. You are start beginning to learn Arabic language and use the same language, you must translate it. But the moment you go to the advanced stage, you can use Arabic language to learn Arabic language. Okay? It helps a lot. So the first lesson here, we have Ad-Darsul Awwal. Ad-Darsul Awwal. Ad-Darsul Awwal means lesson one. Okay? You can see in page 5, lesson one. Ad-Darsul Awwal. هذا The first lesson is talking about هذا. Okay? هذا means what? This is. Okay? So if you want to say this is a boy, what do you say? هذا ولد. If you want to say this is a mosque, what do you say? هذا مسجد. If you want to say this is a book, هذا. If you want to say this is an exercise book, what do you say? هذا دفتر. Orders are waiting for orders to start, and they follow them. You don't do that, okay? If you don't know, you say what? لا أدري. You say la adri. Naam. Daftar, you should be able to write it. Okay? Hada daftar means this is an exercise book. You want to say this is a bed. How do you say that in Arabic? Hada sarirun. If you want to say this is a man, how do you say that in Arabic? Hada rajulun. Okay? So hada means this is. You can bring any noun to form your complete what? What type of sentence? Verbal or nominal? Ismiya or fi'liya? Ismiya. The moment you start the sentence with hadha, that sentence automatically it is jumlatul ismiya, a nominal sentence. Okay, this ha here, and we have tha. Ha here, it means, okay, harfu tanbih. Harfu tanbih. Harf tanbih, the harf of attention. The harf of attention. Tanbih means attention, okay? The harf of attention. Harf tanbih. If you want to say somebody, if you want to say to someone, pay attention, how do you say it? Huh? Intabih. If you want to say to someone, how do you say it? Intabih. Be careful. It depends on the person you are talking to. Huh? If it is one man, or one boy, or whatever, a male, you say what? Intabih. If it is a female, you say what? Intabihi. That's why if I ask you, how do you say someone pay attention? Don't say intabih. Ask the person, what type of person do you mean? So you have to be innovative here. Don't be trapped. This is Arabic, okay? You have to say, in English you can say pay attention to group of people. But in Arabic, intabih means one man. Female, intabihi, one female, okay? If it is group of males, intabihu. If it is group of males and group of males combined together, intabihu. You see, this is how we say it. So half of tanbih, half of attention. Okay? You want to shout at somebody, you say, hey. So that's, it's called ha.
What about
two males?
Two males
in tabiha.
What about
two females in tabiha? The same. Okay? All right. So that here is called ismul ishara. Okay, ismul ishara. That's this dha here. You're talking. You are seeing here. The dha and the ha is harfu tanbih. So this is the breakdown of hadha. Okay, this is. So you can see on page 5, the first one is what? Hadha baytun. This is a house. The second one is hadha masjidun. This is, what is the meaning? This is a mosque. Hadha babun. The next one is hadha babun. This is a door. And the other one, hadha kitabun. This is a book. Okay? Qalamun, hadha qalamun, this is a pen. We have miftahun, hadha miftahun, this is a key, okay? Miftah means a key. How do you say, where is my key? Or where is the key? Aynal? Aynal miftah, good. How do you say, where is the pen? Aynal qalam. So miftah means a key. Hadha miftahun is just opening the door. You can use any way of constructing using miftah. Ayna al miftah. How do you say the pen is on the table? Al miftahu. You say al. Al miftahu. Because I said the key. When you say the key. The means alif wa lam. It means al. Okay? Al means the. So when I say al miftahu or the key is on the table, how do you say? Al-miftahu alal maktab. How do you say the man is on the bed? Ar-rajulu. Don't say rajulun, you say ar-rajulu because the man. Ar-rajulu alas-sariri. Alas-sariri. The man is on the bed. So hadha miftahun, this is a key. The other one is hadha, hadha maktabun. This is a desk or a table. Hada sarirun, this is a bed. Hada kursiyun, this is a chair. So these are the types of sentences we have here under the first lesson for now, using the word hada. All right. The first one is hada baytun. This is a house. How do you say, is this a house? You want to ask someone. Ahada, you have to bring alif. Ahada baytun. Okay, but ahada baytun, this is a house. What type of sentence is this? Al-jumlatul ismiya. It's a nominal sentence. It is composed of two things. Okay, we have mubtada and khabar, the subject and the predicate. Where is the mubtada? Aina al-mubtada, huna? Hada wa mubtada. And aina al-khabar? Baytun is the khabar, is the predicate. Khalas. So this is hada. So we also have a rule that says, you know, this is marfu' and this is marfu' bi damma. Okay? So but you can have this here, al-qa'ida. Al-qa'ida too. the rule. What type of rule are we talking here? Al-mubtada wal-khabaru marfu'an. المبتدا والخبر مرفوعان مرفوعان المبتدا والخبر مرفوعان مبتدا ان خبر ديا مرفوع مبتدا وان خبر مرفوعان اوكي دي سبجكت اند دي بريديكيت دي ار اولويز مرفوع مرفوع از علامه رفع از ضمه الضمه علامه رفع سو وين سي مرفوع يو توكين اباوت مرفوع يو توكين اباوت ضمه يو نو ضمه اوكي وات از ذس فتحه وات از ذس What is this? Dhamma. Okay? So when you talk about marfu, you're talking about Dhamma. One single Dhamma or two Dhammas here. So the Mubtada and Khabar, they're always marfu. For example, okay? You can say Al-Qalamu Maksurun. The pen is broken. Al-Qalamu Maksurun. The pen is broken. Okay? Al-Qalamu is marfu. Bi Dhamma. It has Dhamma at the end. And then maksurun, it has dhamma. When you say marfu'un with dhamma, you are referring to both. Either single or double. So that's what we are saying here. Mubtada and khabar, they are marfu'un. Marfu'an. Okay? Marfu'anun. Both of them, they have these things. Even if you cannot see it, like in the case of hadha, can you see dhamma here? You cannot see dhamma, but it is marfu'un. So you have to memorize this. Al-mubtada wal-khabaru. Marfu'an. Okay? Memorize it always. So that now when you make i'rab, you'll be able to know that this hadha is marfu'. Okay? It's marfu' bi dhamma. And baytun is marfu' bi dhamma. You can see it, but you cannot see it here. So hadha is ismul ishara. Okay? Marfu'an. You can stop there. The i'rab is long, but as beginners, we stop at this level. Hadha, you say mubtada marfu'. Baytun is khabar marfu'. Okay? I will write that for you. The Arab of Hada Baytun. This is Al Mubtada wal Khabaru Marfu'an. Okay? You have to memorize this rule always. When you hear Mubtada, know that it's Marfu'. And when you hear Khabar, know that it's Marfu'. The word Al Rafu will be mentioned in their grammatical analysis. Hada baytun. So hada is mubtada, the i'rab. You can say i'rabun. I'rab. The i'rab of this sentence, hada baytun. You say hada, that's the grammatical analysis of this sentence. Hada first. Hada is mubtada, but you don't start with mubtada. You say ismul hada. You can start with mubtada as beginners. Mubtada. Hada mubtada un marfu'un. Marfu'un. You stop there. As beginners, when you proceed, when you move forward to book two, there's a different way of analyzing this hadha. You can say ismul ishara, mabniyun ala sukun, fi mahalli raf'in, mubtada. But to your level, please stop here. Hadha, you say hadha is mubtada and is marfu'. That's the grammatical analysis. It is mubtada and is marfu'. Marfu' bimada, you can say bi dhamma, because when you talk about marfu', you are referring to dhamma. That's it. It is always, because it's mubtada. That's why we wrote that rule. Mubtada'u wal khabaru marfu'an. They are always marfu'. Okay, Dhamma. When you talk about morpho, you're talking about Dhamma. Even you cannot see it, that's the foundation. That's the usul. Okay? So hada mubtada is marfu, and then baitun. What is the i'rab of baitun here? We said is the predicate, is khabar. You can say is khabar. Labaik. Is khabarun marfu'un. Yes. Marfu'un. Khabarun marfu'un bid dhamma. You can add it there. Khabarun marfu'un bid dhamma. Hada, you can say mubtada marfu'un. Khabar baitun. This is baitun. Khabarun marfu'un bid dhamma. You can stop there. Don't go further.
I was going to seek your attention about this.
No, they are just beginning. We just want to. What is the attention?
No, like for me, I was thinking that maybe it was a bit like
beginners. Okay, that's why I just say, hada is mubtada. You say marfu. But they need to know. I gave them the rule of al mubtada wal khabaru marfu'an. It's marfu. Just know that. You know, as your, because we'll be repeating it all every time when we come. Is hada is the mubtada here, and then it's marfu. And then baitun is khabar, and it's marfu. That's all. It's marfu, huh? Barin? D? Naam, naam. So hada baitun. All right. This is a house. If you want to make Arab, that is hada baitun. Hada is mubtada, and baitun is khabar. You can stop there as well, okay? Yes. Mada Turid, what do you want? Arab Kamilan? Al-Qalamu Maksurun. You want to make Arab of Al-Qalamu Maksurun. Al-Qalam huwa Mubtada, Marfu'un Bid-Dhamma. Naam. Khabarun, Marfu'un Bid-Dhamma. Al-Qalam Maksurun. Al-Qalam is Mubtada, Marfu'un Bid-Dhamma. And then Maksurun is Khabarun, Marfu'un Bid-Dhamma. That's all. But Hada here is, you can say Mubtada, Marfu'un. And then Khabar, Al-Baytun, you say Khabar, Marfu'un. That's all. Now, as beginners, you can stop here. All right, so let's briefly talk about the conditions of Hada. I think before we end the class, the conditions of hada. Okay? Shurutu hada. Shurut. Shurut means conditions. Okay? Shurutu hada. You can say the conditions of hada. The conditions of. Before you use hada. You know, when you talk about shurut, it's something that you do before the action. Am I right? For example, you say shurutu salah, the conditions of as salah. For example, what is the condition of salah? Okay? You have to be a Muslim, you have to perform ablution before you establish the prayer. Those are conditions. Also, hada, it has shurut. Shurutu hada, conditions of hada. Hada, the conditions. For you to use hada, it has to be what? Qarib. What is qarib? It has to be close or near. Close or near. It has to be nearby. And then that is qarib, because if it is far, what do you use? If it is one thing you are pointing at, dhalika. So hada, it has to be close. The next one is mudhakkar, it has to be masculine. مذكر masculine. It has to be masculine. For example, the meaning of bintun is what? Bintun, a girl. How do you say this is a girl? Hadhihi bintun. Okay, we use hadhihi for feminine. This is masculine. It has to be masculine. Hadha waladun, hadha baytun. Okay, the last one is what? Mufrad. Mufradun. It has to be what? Singular. So for you to use hadha, these conditions have to meet. Qareeb, it has to be close, it has to be mudhakkar, it has to be mufrad. For example, hadha baytun. For example, hadha baytun. Hadha baytun. Hadha baytun. Okay, now we are using hadha. This condition of khabar. So the khabar is qareeb, the bayt is very close to us, it's close, it's near, and it is masculine, and it is singular. What is the plural of baytun? Huh? Buyutun. Huh? So here is singular. Hadha baytun, because it's masculine, it's close to us, and it is singular. That's why we are using hadha. Otherwise, we cannot use hadha. Inshallah, if you have any question, we can take your questions. If you don't have, inshallah, we can end this dars for today. Naam. Hmm? Pardon? Do you have any question? Aindakum su'al, any question? He is coming. How do you say it? Huwa ya'ti. Huwa ya'ti. Yes, he is coming. We learn that later. He is coming. You can say huwa ya'ti. He is coming. Yes. He is going. You know that. Huwa yadhhabu. He is going. Okay? Okay. He's coming, he's going. Huwa ya'ti, he's coming. And then huwa yadhhabu, he is going. Any question regarding this lesson? Hada, any question? Aindakum su'al? Do you have any question? Naam. Good question. He asks even in using Arabic language. Mal farku baina al-aqsam wal-anwa'. They are all the same. Huma sawa. You say what? He's asking what is the difference between aqsamun because we mentioned it in the dars. When we ask a question, let's leave it with this dars specifically. Aqsamun and anwa'un. What is the difference? Aqsam means what? Types. And then anwa' means types. You can interchange them, they're the same. Naam, types, aqsam. Okay? You can say qismun, like, you can say parts also, types or parts. Parts. You can say parts. Parts of speech. Aqsamul kalam. You can say parts of speech. Parts. Or you can say types of speech. Okay? And then anwa' means type. Yes, any question? Aindakum su'al? Huh? Groups? No, no, no. It's not. Naam. Al-qalamu maksurun. Al-qalamu maksurun. Good question. Okay? We have a... What is the question? Al-qalamu maksurun. Al-qalamu Maksurun. And which one?
Al-Qalamul Maksuru.
Al-Qalamul Maksuru. Al-Qalamul Maksuru. He said, what is the difference between the two? Okay, al-qalamu maksurun, the pen is broken. That is the meaning of al-qalamu maksurun. The pen is broken. And this is a type of, which type of sentence is this? Al-jumlatul fi'liya or ismiya? Ismiya, because it begins with a noun. Al-qalam is the mubtada and maksurun is khabar. You can stop there, okay? And then, al-qalamu maksurun, what is the meaning? The broken pen. Even in English, are they the same? The pen is broken and the broken pen. This is a sentence, right? And this one also is what? Is it a phrase or a sentence? For me, I'm not good at English. So I can't. Bias, can you help? Is this a phrase or a complete sentence? It's a phrase. What about this one? It's a complete sentence, of course, because we have there. In Arabic, this is also called a complete sentence. That's why I said Arabic is mathematics. Watch. Al-qalamu maksurun, we have nothing to do with here. This one is a complete sentence. Nothing should be added. Okay? If nothing is added, for example, it's still complete. Al-qalamu maksurun, which type of sentence is this? It's a sentence. Something is hidden somewhere. Something is hidden somewhere. I will tell you why it's a complete sentence. It's jumlatul? It's miya. Why? Because it begins with a noun, right? Where's the muftada? Where's the subject? Where's the muftada here? Al-qalam. And maksurun is? Khabar. Is this the same as ad-darsul awwal? They're the same. Ad-darsul awwal is the same as al-qalamu maksuru. Al-qalamul maksuru is the same way. الدرس الأول القلم مكسور and الباب المفتوح and which one? They are all the same combination. The same. But you cannot say القلم is مبتدأ. It's wrong. Say why? Do you agree? Yes. Something is hidden somewhere. القلم مكسور القلم المكسور something is hidden here. It's called هذا. Complete it. Read this one. How do you say this? هذا القلم مكسور. So in this case, we have to remove here. Something here. Okay? هذا القلم مكسور. The other one, القلم المكسور is نعت and منعوت. It's another level. We will learn it later. It's نعت and منعوت. نعت is مكسور. المكسور is نعت. And then القلم is Manu'ut, yes, it's manu'ut. It's na'at and manu'ut, okay? The na'at comes after the manu'ut. It's an adjective. But now, you want to make a complete sentence, that makes sense. You want to conjugate a complete sentence here. What do you say? هذا القلم مكسور. What is the meaning? هذا القلم مكسور. What is the meaning? This is, remember, هذا means this is. القلم, no. You see, you are having اختلاف العلماء. اختلاف العلماء. This is why English is a problem anyway. English language is a problem. Arabic, you cannot make mistakes in Arabic language. It's not possible. So, هذا القلم مكسور. What is the meaning? How do you write it in English? This is the broken pen. You see, اختلاف العلماء. The scholars have differed now.
That's what, that is why it's not
but there's alif and lam here.
Yes, but if you add alif and lam to the maksur, this broken pen.
So now, هذا القلم مكسور.
This pen is broken.
This pen is broken. Do you agree with him?
Yes.
You agree? Yes. Chorno, yes. You say you don't agree? This is the broken pen. Yes, any other observation? Naam. This is a?
Hada kalamun maksur. This is a broken pen.
Yes. This is a broken pen. Hada kalamun maksurun. This is hadal kalamu with alif and lam. Wait, you have deferred. Now let me come and intervene. Hada kalamun maksurun. Good. Hada kalamun maksurun. You see now, hada kalamun maksurun. What is the meaning? Don't say this pen is broken. This is a? Good. Hada kalamun maksurun. This is a broken pen. And the mubtara is hada. Kalamun is what? It's khabar. And then maksurun is naat. It's an adjective. It's naat. We will learn it later. Don't worry. Hada kalamun maksurun. This is a broken pen. Now the first one now. It cannot have the same meaning with this. So now tell me, what is the meaning of the first one? This is the broken pen.
Now, can I break it down?
Yes.
Can I break it down?
Yes.
Hadal kalam.
Yes.
This pen. Hadal kalam. This pen,
huh? Mm-hmm.
Hadal kalam.
No. Hadal kalam. This pen.
Hadal kalam.
Hadal kalam. This is a pen. Okay. Hadal kalam. This pen. Maksurun. Is broken.
So this pen is. This do you agree with him? He said, "Hadal kalam maksurun." This pen is broken. Anyway, if you say this pen is broken, it's still correct. But hadha qalamu maksurun, this is the broken pen. This is a broken pen, yes. But hadha qalamu maksurun, this is the broken pen, is still correct. You can say that this is the broken pen. And the one you said is what?
No, this pen is broken.
This pen is broken.
This is the broken pen. It's hadha qalamu maksurun.
Hadha qalamu?
Al-maksuru.
No, in that case, it will not be right, because I will tell you one thing here. This is what you call badal. It's another level. We will learn it. Don't write. Don't worry. I'll call him here. Anytime, any noun that comes after hadha, and it has alif and lam, is called badalun. It's something that can be replaced. Badal. I don't know whether you understand. Badalun. So you can replace this one. You can skip it. And say hada maksurun. This is broken. It doesn't make sense. It makes sense. This is broken. So here is called badal for hada. It's badalun, means something that can be replaced. Okay? It's a substitute. And then hada is mubdal minhu. It's mubdal minhu. That's another level. We will read there. So hada al qalamu maksurun. Hada is mubtada and khabar is maksurun. You don't say al-qalamu is khabar. No. Maksurun is khabar. Al-qalamu is badalun. You say what? Say it again. Badalun. It's a substitute, because it can be substituted with what? It can be with hadha. It can be substituted with hadha. You can say al-qalamu maksurun. The pen is broken. Okay? Al-qalamu maksurun. The pen is broken. And then you can say hadha maksurun. This is broken. So that's why we say al-qalamu here is badal. It's a substitute, badalun. Badalun. Badalun means a substitute, okay? So now it can substitute hadha. Al-qalamu maksurun, or you say hadha maksurun. So anytime you see alif and lam, okay, after hadha is called badalun. It's many in the Quran. It's plenty. For example, wa laqad sarrafna fi hadhal Quran. Yes, in this Quran. Inna hadha al Quran. So, walaqad sarrafna fi hadhal Quran. You can see. Fi hadhal Quran. Hadha, after hadha, what comes? Al Quran or Quranun? Which one? Al Quran. So, that Al Quran is a substitute for hadha. Allah can say, walaqad sarrafna fi al Quran. That's why, fi hadhal Qurani. Because it's kasra when you check it. Why? Because hadha, because Al-Quran is a substitute for hadha. And hadha is ismul ishara, and then is what you call, harfu jar? Ismul majrur. So in that case, Al-Quran also is, hadha is ismul majrur. Because it's replacing what? It can be replaced to, interchange to, we have to write the verb to understand because it's long. وَلَقَدْ صَرَفْنَا فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. For example, فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. Okay? فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. فِي هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. This is how it's written in the Quran. So, فِي is what? Harfu jar. And then hadha, here in this case, you can say ismul ishara, mabniin ala sukun, fi mahalli jarrin, ism majrur. This is a complete way of doing i'rab. But as beginners, don't worry about it. So just say it's ismul ishara, but it is ism majrur. Because the surname of fi is what? Harfu jar. What is the surname of harfu jar? I'm giving it a surname. It's not mentioned like surname in Arabic text. It's from me. Harfu jar, ism majrur. You have to get used to that. So that anytime harfu jar comes, the next one is, it must be ismul majrur. So hadha here is ismul majrur, and Al-Quran is badal. It's a substitute for hadha. You can say, walaqad sarrafna fil Qur'ani, or walaqad sarrafna fi hadha al-Quran. Don't recite fil Qur'ani, it's not there. I'm just telling you, grammatically, it's possible. So here, in this Quran, okay, al-hadha al-qalamu maksurun, the meaning is what? The pen is?
This pen is because earlier, you did not say the Quran. You said in this Quran.
Mm-hmm.
So hadha al-Quran, mm-hmm. This Quran.
Mm-hmm.
So hadha al-qalamu, this pen, maksurun, is broken.
This pen is broken, okay? Hadha al-qalamu maksurun, that's the correct translation. Hadha al-qalamu maksurun, this pen is broken. Hadha qalamun maksurun, this is a broken pen. That's all. So this is mubtada, this is khabar, this is naat, okay? Hadha al-qalamu maksurun, this is the mubtada, and this is badal, it's a substitute for hadha, and then it's maksurun. Why substitute? Because you can start the sentence here. Al-qalamu maksurun is still correct. Or you can say hadha maksurun. Okay, so this is a substitute for hadha. It's called badalun, a substitute. Inshallah, if you don't have any question, we can stop here until next week. So please revise your lessons and try to talk to each other using Arabic language. If you can mix with Arabic students, the little that you have learned here, try to express them. Okay, anywhere you go, try to speak Arabic language, inshallah. I'll take your assignment seriously. صلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته